Mr. Brian Kelly. I love the extension of the name, Optimistic Rebel.
Yeah, I've been putting that on my little name thing here. It's a Claude Silver reference in terms of, I've got a t-shirt that she sent me that says Optimistic Rebel. It's part of, I think, what her brand is. I'm like, that applies to me too. I think I'll use that.
You've mentioned it, her name to me. You guys have been connected for a while, and I'm assuming she's had somewhat of a big impact on your life at this point.
Yeah. So through Mike Conti and the Human Source community, to meet her in the, I think it was back in 2020, the first time. I forget the timing of it. COVID seems like a decade long.
Yes.
Two or three years. So the time lapse there is a little bit off. But yes, and she's had a huge impact in terms of her heart-centered leadership. She's the chief heart officer. So think about that as a title and a company, a global company, and how you lead for people and experience in an organization. Through being who you genuinely are and caring about people. And so she's the sort of representation of everything I'd like to see more of in business and companies and how people are valued, treated, and appreciated.
Mm-hmm. Well, you've now, I'm not going to say always, because I haven't always known you, but as long as I've known you, you've been that type of person, someone who values people, who supports them. And I think even in this kind of next phase, so to speak, of your life, as well as my life, I know one of the things that you mentioned to me is this desire of wanting to leave better things than you found them, supporting people along their journey and along their paths. And I'm curious, maybe even before we dive into you receiving the book and what that experience was like, where did that even come about? Do you remember like one of the first times in your life where you're like, hey, I really want to see this type of change, and I'm going to do something with it?
Yeah, and so part of it is just what my strengths are, right? So one of the strengths finder strengths is called maximizers, my number two strength. And so it's always, I'm just wired to kind of look for, seek, be able to see what better might look like, right? And so better, it's not like one particular kind of better. It's not Brian's version of better. What does better look like for you? Your professional career and your relationships and your day, right? And your how you're showing up in the world, how you see yourself, right? And oftentimes it's growing people's relationships with the human factors, accelerate their performance, their relationships, and their fulfillment. That's what I found in human factors consulting. Because I believe that growth is rooted in growing your relationship with human factors. For me, it was vulnerable. And that changed everything, because it changed how I saw myself. It changed how I showed up in the world. And I believe most people have an opportunity there to first identify what that might be, whether it's vulnerability or some other human factor, curiosity, kindness, control, fear, whatever it might be, right? And have a healthy relationship. So it's about healthy and unhealthy, not good or bad. Good or bad is definitely healthy or unhealthy.
Do you remember one of the first people who opened that door for you?
In terms of better,
and also I think creating a space where vulnerability is a topic that was okay to engage with and include within kind of your own life. Because I know you, when you and I have spoke, you and I obviously have spoken many times, but one of the more recent times you spoke about the concept of vulnerability and your own relationship with it and kind of getting more comfortable with that. And I was just curious, was there someone in your life, some conversation, some moment that said, you know, maybe I should try that, or maybe I would like to explore this more?
Yeah. So it was really my own journey. Going through Georgetown for my first coaching program, where got accepted into the program. There's about five people from workplace that had been through the program. My mentor was one of them. He gave me a heads up. Hey, you're going to have to, you know, be sure stuff because you're going to be doing triad coaching as part of the practice and growing your coaching capabilities. And I was like, sure, I'm a team player. Sure, I'll do that. But the inner voice on the side of my shoulder was saying, but I'm going to control what that looks like. I'm going to control the level of vulnerability. And so really, it was my experience going through Georgetown, first deciding, you know, having to come to grips with, is this something I really want to do, or is it just kind of a notion that I like and that is interesting to me at this point? Because I was struggling through the program, early coaching. I know how to help you instead of kind of getting curious and going through those growing pains. And then I had to get, you know, the part of what was getting in the way of me being who I knew I could be in terms of someone that could help people change their relationships with whatever they're dealing with. And so I came out of that process identifying my relationship with vulnerability as being unhealthy. I had come to believe growing up from vulnerability meant weakness and different things that kind of reinforced that through other behaviors of, you know, adults and messages of, you know, like in sports, like, oh, don't rub it if you get hurt, whatever, you know, men don't cry. This machoism stuff was first part of, you know, growing up and sort of the messaging that continues to be out there for men and how men are supposed to be. And you can be strong with being, in fact, you know, it's reframing how you see vulnerability. That was the reframing. So vulnerability meant weakness was up until then. And then it had to be a reframe that meant something to me, right? It couldn't just be, oh, this will help me get through the program. Good, yes. I got that, right? I was like, well, that's not going to work, right? So how am I going to work with leaders and invite them into what's naturally going to be something that might be need them to be vulnerable and step into vulnerability with authenticity if I didn't have an authentic and healthy relationship with it? So I came out of that with the realization and the belief, the chosen belief, not the learned belief, the chosen belief that vulnerability is human. It's how we connect with one another. And it's actually one of our greatest strengths. It's just we've been sort of looking in a way that compounds the negative impact of someone that feels vulnerable, because then they just withdraw and then they go into themselves and then they don't show up instead of asking for help or believing in themselves or having the courage to try something new or whatever that might be. And so that became my relationship with vulnerability then became the foundation of sort of why I went to coaching, professional development, people development, team development, because the dynamics that businesses are looking to grow in terms of engagement and all those things, it's all rooted and people and the relationships with themselves, the relationships with others. Think about people's relationships with judgment. What if that shifted to acceptance? I saw that happen for me firsthand in Georgetown because I came in with some judgment of self and other stuff. And I flipped that as part of this vulnerability journey to acceptance. And that changed some relationships with family and others because of that. So there's multiple positives that come out of just being true to yourself and not worrying about how it might look or those things, the external factors, and just being real. So I had to get real with myself, and then that's what happens when folks in the space. It's just you and me, or it's just us, and there's no good or bad, it's just whatever it is, right? It's just focusing on what's real, what's what you'd like to be healthier, right? And it's not what's healthier for Oleg. Let's get Oleg up to what's healthier for Brian. It's wherever you are, let's, what does the next step look like? And so that's my notion of maximizers, looking at better, not looking at, you know, the daunting thing of what the end game is, because that causes people to sometimes get overwhelmed. what does the next step look like? What action do I need to take to support this? Are my actions and habits consistent with where I want to go? And so it's a lot of that. And so it really wasn't anything external. It was actually something internal in a situation that I was invited into. And it made me realize how I looked at, oh, you got to be vulnerable in this situation. And it's like, I was being strategic and how I was going to navigate it before I even got into it, right? And so think about that. Think about how that might have been with relationships and other things that were showing up in life. But I didn't have the self-awareness at the time to notice it, but then I grew that. So now I help people with that as well, the self-awareness piece of it.
Well, part of the journey that I've also realized in even creating these books, kind of tying how you and I even connected for this particular podcast, was it's been so interesting to see people receive it in such drastically different ways, right? Some people literally call you back in tears, hey, can't believe it, why me, type of thing. And then other people express it in different ways. From some people you don't hear back from, and let's say like a week or a month, and it's like, that's how long it took me to really process. But I was curious in your case, because you brought up a very interesting point, and I know it's something that you and I have discussed as well as many other people, and that's the concept of vulnerability, especially when it applies to males. Mm. Part of it has to do with the story that I think many or some, whatever that number looks like, were taught to believe or accepted ourselves, and that's men don't cry, men don't talk about feelings. And when you get something like this, it at least my experience of gifting it to other people and being there in person or from afar, it seems that you almost can't help it but to be tapped into these human elements of who you are when you receive messages like that, right? Because they're just like a... Yeah, you can skim over it, but at the same time, words are really fascinating because in concept, they're just words, just a bunch of letters put together. But the feelings they can evoke from you and how they can tap into your heart, and all of a sudden, you're just in the middle of anywhere, wherever, just crying and thinking of all these memories. And so I was curious in your case, and I know with your book, we got majority of the people that you worked with, I think, and more of like a professional setting, right?
People.
But even in that case, I'm sure it tugged on some element of who you are, tugged on some heartstrings, right?
Oh, well, absolutely. I mean, that you said it right there. The word that came up was heart. Like, it goes right to your heart when you receive something like this, right? And so, honestly, if this happened about a decade ago, because that was part of the thing that happened in Georgetown, was my awareness of how disconnected I was from feeling and my feelings. And so I was witnessing, you know, as I mentioned, the triad coaching. And so one of the roles is observer. I was an observer of an emotional coaching session that was, was something that was sensitive. And my learning circle advisor, so Brian, what came up for you then? What did you say? I had nothing. Like, how did that strike you? And I was so disconnected because I'd learned to do that to protect myself, right? And in terms of the vulnerability and being in self-protective mode, that I'd become disconnected from my feelings. And so when I say that things changed afterwards, it didn't happen overnight, but I got reconnected to my body, being able to feel stuff and have that be indicators for awareness for different things. And so when you receive a book like and a gift like this, you know, moments worth remembering.
Did you think at a certain point you would get one?
I didn't know.
That was the best.
I didn't know. Knowing how kind you are in our relationship, I thought, well, maybe. I had no idea. Yeah. And so I got it. I was like, wow. The people that took the time to write something, photos, the people that contributed photos, that brought me back to those times. And there were people from my personal life, from my professional life, and people that I haven't spoken with in a while. And so the thing that about the moments worth remembering work that you're doing is it's reconnecting people and reconnecting you to joyful memories, right? And so to have people's own words describe how you impacted their life. And that's, you know, that's the thing with the book is the starting point for the invitation of the testimonials is a question of how was this person a gift in your life or some form of that, right?
Yes.
And to hear people that I recently just met, like Elisa, like I literally met her six months ago, and or someone that I've known for, you know, a decade or more, or longer in life. But we don't say that to people. We don't say what we put in the book, oftentimes we won't say to our family and friends. And that's the power of what you're doing here. It's reconnecting people. And what more time, what better time right now when the world is so fragmented and disconnected to kind of reach out and say, hey, this teacher, this person that's retiring that's had an impact on my life, like you did with yours, a mentor, or someone that was at my school that was a huge part of my journey. I'd like to do something for them. I'd like to gift them a moment's worth of memory in the book, and touch, and then reach out to their network and connect to the people in their lives. Help whoever might be inspired to contribute to through their lens. What a gift, Oleg, be in their life. And think about if you can do that for someone is either later on in their life, retiring, graduating, maybe it's a milestone birthday, an anniversary, celebration, promotion, whatever that might be. There's so many different ways to celebrate people. And this is lasting because it's a book you can always refer back to. And kind of, I was looking at it last night, and I was like, wow, I'm starting to remember the time that I spent with these folks. And it's like, wow, the last time I talked to this person or spoke with this person was this. And it was great to get some people that had different perspectives of me. Some people had perspectives of working with me. Some people had perspectives of working with me in corporate. Some people had personal reflections in terms of Jason. I helped him run for Congress. I just met him like within a year, but he needed help running for Congress in the local area in Northern Virginia. So I helped him do that. I'm one of his daughter's godfathers. And it's like there's certain relationships that just, you know, happen. It doesn't necessarily have to be a long time, but you can have an impact. And connect with people and remain friends for a long time by just being open to it.
Yeah. Well, I think the other thing, and you hit the nail on the head as far as I personally have learned and continuing to learn that not only is vulnerability not expressed, but I think these words often are not expressed. Part of it, I think, has to do with the fact that the question is rarely even asked. Who are the people that impacted your life? And then I think within that, there's at least what I've learned through my journey is that rarely has there been a follow-up question, right? How might you thank them? What might you do for them? What inspires you when you think about those times in your life? And I think I personally, and I've shared this with you, I've taken almost a responsibility around it. And that's being able to do this and create this for people and give them a chance to know it when they're alive. Now, within that, it's also been a fascinating journey, right? Because as I'm sure you've seen through your own work, some of the people that I've gifted this to, they had a very difficult time receiving it. Now, they have no challenges expressing saying I love you, but when it's done the other way around, it's a different journey that the person goes through and you can see it, you know, it's happening right in front of you. And I think that doing things like this, taking a step back and acknowledging people at different chapters and journeys of our lives, for me, it's, I mean, what more is there? at the end of the day, right? What more is there besides the time that we spend on this earth and the people and the beings we cross paths with and the experiences we create with them? Like, for me, it may sound like a simple version of life, but that's really, for me, what it is. Like, that's what ends up becoming memories. That's what ends up becoming inspiration for future experiences. It's rarely the things that I buy, or it's rarely the latest version of the iPhone that I have that I remember, right? But it's the things that I was able to do with it, and it's the people. It's the trips I was able to go on. It's the schools I was able to attend. It's the different people. I mean, you and I connected because of another person.
Mm-hmm.
And then from there, the journey evolved, and then we were able to connect to other groups and other people. So I think doing something like this, at least for me at this chapter of my life, it's why not?
And it's incredible. And this reflects your heart and who you are, even kind of come up with this kind of an idea and put it into action and bring life to it. You brought up the concept of receiving.
Mm-hmm.
Receiving love or praise or just thanks from other people. And there's an element of vulnerability in that, right? People's relationship with receiving can be considered human. Many people will praise other people and
yes,
celebrate other people. No problem. They'll find something to celebrate about them. But they don't find something to celebrate about themselves, or they're been taught that, be humble. Don't like be too big-headed, and when people celebrate, so they've learned to kind of poo-poo, if you will, I don't know, or dismiss praise and celebration and people acknowledging what's great about them, their strengths, their contributions. And one of the things most people that work with have trouble doing is receiving.
Yeah,
it's really about. And so there's the learned belief, right? And it gets to worthiness, and it gets to all the like underlying factors of what gets in the way of people accelerating their performance, their relationships, and their fulfillment. Isn't it interesting, right? It all comes down to human factor, like receiving, which is rooted in vulnerability and rooted in beliefs and rooted in values. And what if that shifted? What if that shifted to I matter? And thank you. Like, all you really have to do is, you don't have to go into a long explanation.
Yeah.
Thank you is really the best response to something like that. It's short so that you don't feel like, I have to have this long kind of conversation about this. But a true appreciation and thank you is worth a million words.
Yes.
And so, like, thank you for my book.
Yeah.
But for all the hundreds and thousands and millions eventually that you'll be creating and gifting to people, because so many people right now need to feel like they matter.
Yes.
And parents, teachers, people that may be marginalized or not think they have a place in this world. The elderly is a huge population. People that may be in retirement homes, living in assisted living. So think about this as my parents get into that age. Think about the recent pandemic experience.
Yeah.
People didn't get to say goodbye. Like all that and what you're doing now. And so people can get it, the feelings out and shared and captured while they're still living, priceless.
Yeah. I think also part of that journey, if there's anything that I've learned through COVID, it's that you never know what's around the corner. And you never know whether that thing is around your corner or somebody else's corner. And just understanding that part and the fact that, I mean, to some degree, life happens almost with and without you, right? There are components that you get to contribute to your life and the life of other people. And then there's the life outside of that just happens. I mean, events going kind of in a series of its own. And then from there, all the other things that grow and evolve. And I realized that COVID was a very interesting time, A, because of what you just described. I mean, I think you and I have even been a part of groups or probably even know people that we're both connected to who have lost somebody and they weren't able to say a goodbye to because of the restrictions, right? Like only one person at the hospital or one person here, only one person there, mm-hmm. which I can't even imagine. It's very difficult to relate or trying to understand what that experience was like to go through the passing of someone and you're not even able to be in the same room due to hospital restrictions right at the beginning of it all. And then you have people, I know a handful of people who have passed from that and heard about it months after because there's just no, you know, there's just no way. There's no way to spread on the information to find out who had passed from what. And so I think doing things like this, I think expressing them to other people, to some degree, it's what makes this human experience more enjoyable. I think it also what makes us more human. Because at the end of the day, and you started this at the very beginning, as far as the thought goes, I think vulnerability is probably one of the more, I don't know if powerful is the right word, one of the more crucial language of what it means to be human. I mean, that in a way, it removes everything. It removes the layers, the meaning that we choose to give to each one of these things, right? Like good, bad, or I like this, I don't like that. It just cuts straight through. It's almost like a direct path to your heart and how you really feel and what you really think about the person, your life, the things that you experience. And if anything, I think the other thing I'll add on is it really is a beautiful journey to be human. And part of the reason why is because not only is change possible, change is happening every single day, every single moment. So yes, there might have been times where we didn't express vulnerability like we do today, or we were taught these things, man, don't cry or don't talk about your feelings or emotions. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't mean that it's not possible. It doesn't mean that things can't change. And it doesn't mean that that change can't happen now.
So true. You bring me back to this statement. Change is inevitable.
Yes. Yes.
It's life, right? And so resisting change is sort of futile, right? I thought they came up with this, right? We talk about I matter, you matter, everybody matters. Yeah. And yet none of us matter in the big scheme of things. So there's that dichotomy of, yes, you do matter. In the grand scheme of things, right? No one's more important than anybody else, right? It's us yes. together that's going to create better, right? I talk about creating better together because that's how we do it, right? How many yeah. people over a prolonged period of time create all this awesomeness by themselves? I still haven't found that person. Many can do it for a period of time, maybe, you know, right? And so think about the opportunity of growing. My relationship shifted with ability. Just whatever is getting in the way of you just, you know, showing up as your most human, vulnerable, bold, courageous, curious self.
Yeah.
However many of those human factors you want to put in there. And not having shame about it. And getting, you know, whether it's support from a coach or if it's something that's more serious, whatever professional, a therapist, or whoever might help you. There's no shame in that, right? There's no shame in getting the help you need. And that's another thing that I think comes up too in terms of vulnerability is, and you know, men had this during my life too, with going to the doctor, right? And going to get help. And oh no, I'll rub it or put a band-aid on it or do it. Or more realistically, I'll ignore it. And so it gets into other things like mental health and those things more prevalent nowadays too. And seeking the help they need, and that's something that I do too. And so even that, getting more men to kind of let go of the, I need to be this macho guy and that tough guy and not share my feelings and not be vulnerable and be strong, whether it's physical, emotional, mentally, however. You can, it's a yes and, it's not an either or.
Yes.
I think you grew up with either or, and it's really a yes and. That's the opportunity. And really, it comes back to the word, it's an invitation, right? It's an invitation. Yeah. What this book is an invitation to share your feelings and emotions about people that have had an impact on your life, who care about you,
yeah,
and to celebrate the people in our lives who have. And so it's an invitation to think about those people. And to, hey, if you've got an occasion that you want to gift, you know, someone's graduation, retirement, whatever it might be, think about a member's worth remembering book, because this is something that, as you mentioned before, and this is really the best part of the whole thing, is words that may not have been spoken.
Yes.
Absent this invitation to share. People are going to get to see those words and have it compiled in a book that they can reference back to, that can uplift them at any moment where they may not be feeling their best. And that's the biggest, you know, win for me. And there's tons of wins with this. That's the biggest one. Someone, and this is why people later in their life, right? Because different things happen that kind of take them away from everyday engagement with people. Or maybe it's just a very few people. And what if referencing back to family members, friends, people throughout their life, thought about them, it takes them back to those joyful times, gets them to relive that, and maybe encourages them, inspires them to reach out and have a conversation. There's so much you're doing with this that is amazing, Oleg. So I celebrate you and thank you for that. And for my book too, because how did I feel? My heart leapt when I when I got it, right? It's like, I got one. I knew you were doing it. I was like, I didn't know this was coming. And then the cover too, it's got the photos on the cover, but it's also inside. It's got the words from the different people sharing their perspectives on the gift you were in their life. And then there's different photos that people contribute. So wonderful. Uplifting. Thank you for putting me in this and having me on the podcast to share. I will be a passionate supporter of you in this effort until I'm here.
No, thank you. And thank you. You've made my life better in many ways. And I'll tell you a couple of the ones that come to mind. So, first, when I crossed paths with you, we were introduced. It's funny because you and I were trying to recall how the connection even happened. It was through Kira. It was through Kira's story, I think it was.
It was through, her adoption story.
Yes, I think it was.
Through overcoming odds and the connection. Yep.
I remember connecting through that. And instantly, one of the things that stood out to me about you at that time, which continues to stand out for me about you today, is your choice of words. You're very, very intentional in the words that you choose, which in some ways make, not only for me, makes the conversation that much more enjoyable or insightful, but it also that much more impactful, right? Because you understand when to say something, but you also understand when to pause and let just the natural space create itself for whatever it is going to be. That was one of the first things that you helped me become more aware of. And I kid you not, when after the couple conversations we had, I looked at my own journey with my words and what I was doing with them and how I was saying them in a completely different way. I would say you are one of the people who actually helped transform many of the relationships I have in my life because of that. You really helped me become more in tune and more aware of those things. The other thing that I'll say about who you are as a person is you're probably one of the more kind and giving people that I know. And what I mean by that is you just do it because you want to do it. You do it not because, hey, he better give me a review after this, or he better send me, you know, this after that. You just do it. And that's a really fascinating thing, because what it does is it inspires people like myself and whoever else to do similar things if we choose to, right? You're almost creating a door of possibility for other people. Mm-hmm. I mean, certainly there have been times in my own life where I'm like, man, you can only make a connection if they make a connection for you, or if you can only do that, you should only do this if they do that. And then you meet people like you who just do it. You just do it. You don't expect anything in return. I mean, I bet it probably does feel good to get something at some point of the journey, right? But you don't wake up with that expectation. At least that's been my experience of you, is you don't say, okay, I made an introduction for Oleg. He better make one for me in the week or the month, right? You just operate differently. And I think it's such a beautiful thing to experience. And going back to even the whole concept of us humans being a gift, I'm a huge believer of that. I think we're huge gifts to this world, to each other. It's just more so, are we willing to take the time and recognize and see each other as gifts? Because we really are. And think about it. I can name you thousands of interactions, circumstances in my own life where people come into my life, and whether it was helping or whatever their role was, and made my life better. Mm-hmm. That's a gift. That's literally just that. And I can't even explain to you or begin to explain how any of that works. How can a person come into your life and just through a conversation shift your change of being, help you reframe whatever challenges you were experiencing into all of a sudden, like, oh man, you know what? You're right. I did not see that as an opportunity. And all of a sudden, it's like all the molecules within your body are vibrating differently. And now you can leave that conversation thinking that you've reached the top of the mountain when all you did was just sit and enjoy a time with another being. So maybe you did make that climb through the conversation, but it's just like, wow, that is fascinating that a single person can change your trajectory that much. And also in a short period of time.
It's fascinating, right? And so think about what it takes for that to happen. First, you have to be open to it. First, you have to be listening. Mm-hmm. Sometimes we want to talk instead of listening to connect. We often listen to speak, right? We listen to connect. We're co-workers, we're family members. Think about openness, right? What is sort of the antithesis of being open to something? An unhealthy relationship with them. That was the self-effective one that I was in. And so that's why, you know, openness to it, meeting a new person. And so what does that evoke? It evokes curiosity. Oh, what brought you to this event? Or whatever it is, that question you might want to ask, instead of what do you do? And give me your name, rank, and serial number. Ask them a question about them, right? You know, it gets into a networking conversation, which to me is a relationship building conversation. This whole conversation and this whole why you're doing this is about relationships.
Yes.
There's nothing more important. No amount of money, profits, or whatever, you know, they enable organizations to serve people, so that's the benefit. There's nothing more important than the relationships that we connect, connecting with others. Think about what it takes for that to happen. It's being tested. It takes listening. It takes curiosity. All these human factors and ways of being. And, not everybody has had the exposure to awareness, tools, maybe training, or be gifted with a suite of friends that maybe lives in that space, so it makes those kind of conversations and explorations possible. But that's the invitation is, hey, yeah. What if I was just curious about this, you know, next person? I remember something I wrote about. Just saying hi to the cashier at the grocery store and having an interaction with them a while back. And how that shift, you talk about shifting someone's mood or thoughts or way of being. Are you just going to go through the grocery store line? And sometimes I do that because that's where I'm at. But yeah. Just having a conversation like that, it shifted my mood for the whole day. Or saying hi to someone, a stranger, just saying hi, welcome. Opening the door for someone, just a kind gesture. Because you're supposed to do it because you're a man, right?
Yeah.
Because you want to.
Yeah. There's a big difference between the two. Huge difference. Huge difference between
expectations, right? So sometimes we have to question the expectations. And some, you know, Jack talks about this all the time. It's why is he so happy or in a good place and he's been successful? He says, because you have no expectations of other people. And think about that, right? If you don't hold on to an attachment of expectations from a relationship or for another person, you just engage with trust, for possibilities become available.
Yeah. Well, part of that I think has to do with, at least from my experience, it's really, it's almost a, not almost, but it is, I think, a relationship with self. Personally, I haven't experienced this until the last couple of years, and that's understanding that things may happen, and also understanding that it's almost like you end up shifting your whole world. And I think gratitude plays a really big role in that. When I really started to practice this intentionally, not as in, oh, I'll do it whenever I feel like it, but every single day I'm going to commit to at least celebrating one other person. And now I think I'd probably do, I don't know, 10 to 15 to 20 a day. It just becomes such a norm as far as the behavior goes. But I realized that one of the bigger impacts of choosing that practice is the whole world around me became a world of possibilities and opportunities. So when you mentioned Gary speaking about releasing expectation of people, spot on, absolutely. Just doing the best that I can, interacting in the way that we can. And from there, the journey is whatever the journey is, right? Whether they make a connection for you, whether they become the catalyst for whatever version or change that you're hoping to inspire. There's almost no time of trying to think of any of that because I have no idea how or what part of this process truly works. What I have learned is showing up as myself, continue to take action. I think to some degree, action is or maybe one of the universal languages. Like that's what kind of moves the energy, right? That's the transfer of energy from me to you and then vice versa. And then what happens in between, how these things actually create and manifest, I don't know. I have no idea. But I just do know that in doing that, it creates these things within their own time, right? I may expect certain things to happen within a week, and then it happens within a year. Well, it's not that I was wrong or right. If it does happen in a week, it just happened. Like that was the time frame. That's how long it took for these connections along the way to happen, to somewhere along the way, the opportunity to be like, boom, yes.
Yeah, it could be connections. It could be your own growth needing to happen before something else. I mean, there's so many different factors.
Yes.
And talk about giving. So giving to grow is another concept. Giving to get, like, oh, if you give me a life, I'll give you, you know, like the transactional stuff. People feel that, right? And I get messages every day from people wanting to tell me how great their program is and how great the lead generation thing is and all that stuff. And if you haven't built a relationship with me, I don't hear you. That's just the reality of it. You know, it's not that I don't want you, but if you come right at me with that without kind of cultivating a relationship, that does, as a relationship builder, that so give to grow, as a way of being, like it's leading with trust and just, you know, some of these concepts that may be contrary to what we learned, our learned beliefs. Oh, no, you've got to earn my trust. So, you know, and what if you just led with trust? What if, how might that affect the creation of trust?
Mm-hmm.
So, all of these are things I learned in my life, and, personally, professionally. That's why human factors, I think, are so core and fundamental to how we create better. And action is one. So action, creating this space for spreading and joy, spreading and inviting more connection and getting people to say, show it's okay to share my feelings and shift the mindset around our view of certain things, like men shouldn't show their feelings, vulnerability is weakness. Because what that does is it dehumanizes men.
Yes.
So, don't show your feelings. Right, so I'm supposed to turn off my human? By whose measure? You know, who's telling me I need to do this? Like, okay, so I'm supposed to do it in this instance, but in this instance, I'm not, right? And it's like, just be human. That's our journey through life, is to embrace our humanity. And there's some things that are good about that and some things that may challenge us or invite us to kind of see differently and be differently. Isn't that why we're here?
Yeah.
Ultimately.
Mm-hmm. Tell me a little bit more about the human factors consulting. What is it? How do you work with people, or who do you work with?
So it's an evolution of what came out of coaching, right? And so coaching is still part of what I do, but the consulting piece of that is working with small businesses and small and medium-sized businesses and teams and leaders to grow their relationship with themselves, with each other, and to approach business goals from a people's first mindset, practice, and to build habits that enable them to create better together. So we work with them, create some habits and practices, and individually and collectively help them see what better looks like and show them sustainably how we can create better. And it all comes back to people, how people are treated, how we view people, how we celebrate people. And it gets back to the for me, human factors is about creating bond and relationships and people. And from that, everything you want is possible, right? Profits, better retention, better engagement, better whatever. Because at the end of the day, as much as we may have been conditioned otherwise, in the industrial age, the people are robots and they come and they do what you tell them to do. You'll get what you ask from most people. What you won't get is discretionary effort, the ingenuity and innovation and creative thinking that they may have, that, that they may be holding back because they felt when they shut down the table. And so how are we valuing people's uniqueness? How are we looking beyond the job description of what someone has been hired to do to invite the possibility of how might we tap into more of who that person is for their own potential development, growth, and contribution and the betterment of the company and the team? Mm-hmm. What does a leader look like, right? Leaders don't all look like white males. Flash. No, all leaders aren't white males. Yeah, sorry. and so, what if we got curious about differences instead of kind of fearful or staying kind of in that mindset of hiring people like us? Because like us is conditioned for stagnation. It's a code for stagnation, for lack of diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, for being the same. And being the same isn't going to create innovation. It's not going to create better. It's not going to create differentiation. And so there's so many possibilities right there every day, but it's how we look at them and the how we see the invitations there that will determine how we do as companies, opportunities for growth as people, and our ability to create better together. And it's so interesting in this right now that there's so much going on, and yet it's probably the best time in my lifetime for creating.
Yes.
It's the difficult part is for people to become more vulnerable and open to new ways of doing things that it challenges them in ways that they're not comfortable with.
Yeah. And I'm spot on. I'm with you on that. I think there's a lot of truth in this being a really great time for much of this. Part of it has to do with the fact that COVID was a different time. Well, let me rephrase that. COVID is a different time because it's still happening. So I don't want to dismiss what's still actively there. Part of that, the things that it brought up, the opportunities to connect, to value, to reengage, to think about things differently. And I think much of the work that you're doing is around those same exact topics, helping people create that mindset.
Me, it was around fear. Like, how do you feel? Fear is an invitation, right?
Yes.
What do you mean fear is an invitation? Well, it can be.
Yeah. What do you fear? Why do you fear it? How can people connect with you? What's the best way? LinkedIn?
The best way to do that would be LinkedIn or humanfactorsconsulting.net site. Two best ways to reach out. Love to hear from you. If we can help with organization, leadership team.